September. Palms Residential was sponsoring it, put it together. It was supposed to be I forgot the title of it, but a general conversation with ministers and the community. And it was a panel of seven ministers. Al Sharpton was one of the invited guest speakers. And there were a couple of other ministers there, and I cannot remember their names. And I was just surprised at many that still held the notion that it's, you know, one minister got to say, well, all I'm saying is that, you know, the way that most people who get AIDS is homosexual. Right. And so that just turned an audience that was filled with providers.
The least infected are lesbian women.
Well, that, and I kid you not, that's what it said. And of course that generated a lot of very, very tense conversation between the audience and the ministers. And I don't think that's what they meant to do, but it certainly did. And I think the audience kind of felt preached to, and that's not what they came. I think they came there to have a general conversation mm-hmm. about how they could better get this information, what the churches can do to help them, you know, victims of who are HIV positive, people who are HIV positive victims. But that's not quite how it turned out.
I have to tell you a very sad thing. I had Ronnie Samuel Cummins, who I was chair last year of the Committee on Disability at the New Committee Center, maybe 27 years. And I had Ronnie Samuel from the Lesbian, Gay, Bisexual, Transgender Center come speak to the group. And one of the things she said was that it's an astounding number of UCLA undergrads who are HIV positive.
Really?
That really got my attention. Now we've got, yes.
Now, how can we get that data?
Well, contact, by the way, contact Ronnie Samuel. She'd be willing to talk to you and the subject and all that. She's great.
Where is she?
In the old, what do they call it now? The building that was the women's gym? Student activities. She's in the book, Samuel, S-A-N-L-O.
Say it again?
Samuel, S-A-N-L-O. She's in the campus directory.
She's probably down the line.
Donna Bryan?
Yeah. She'll say, oh, she's been at it again.
Okay.
But yes, I haven't explored that further with her, but I think you would like to. And she sees a huge number of students. And it isn't just gay students that come to the center.
Well, because, you know, I work on a project where we're looking for couples that are, one that's HIV positive, one that's negative, and we're looking for the younger population, because for some reason we can't seem to find them.
I went home for Christmas break this year, and in South Africa, ministers are really starting to talk about HIV/AIDS because there's so many people at home infected. And like the biggest church in Soweto is the Church of Christ the King. And the minister there is saying how we have to do a better job as a minister, educating people not only about the disease, but how you get it. Because it's still like the world ends. Rape is like one of the biggest problems because you got these fathers that go to, they don't go to like tradition, like regular doctors. They go to traditional doctors, and these traditional healers are still telling rape numbers are mean, especially in the world ends. If you are infected and you want to rid yourself of the disease, the best way to do it is to have secret conversion.
Yes, I've heard that so many times.
Yeah. The church is not.
I didn't know there were that many virgins out there.
Well, but they are going to little kids.
Yes.
You know, like
yes.
3-4-year-olds.
Yes.
Anyway, that is always disheartening when I hear that, because I keep hearing it over and over again. Well, the focus of this presentation is basically a model that I put together to see, okay, what are some of these reasons why ministers are not becoming more involved? And I should remind you, though, that I started this a couple of years ago. So maybe they're a little bit more involved now, but from that meeting I went to a few months ago, it doesn't seem as if they're open-minded. There are a few exceptions, you know, like, of course, your church and probably a few others. Unfortunately, I didn't necessarily get to those, but I would love to, and that's one of the things I want to do.
You just gave me something to bring up with Robbie Smith.
What's that?
This whole subject. Because okay. I haven't heard it. And, you know, we have guest speakers all the time, too, self-help people, uh-huh. And I don't think I've heard HIV. I've been going there since 91. That's 15 years. I don't think I've ever heard it brought up.
Well, that, yes, I would like for that to be brought up, but I'm also, it's the whole notion of, we have things that are going on in the community and people aren't necessarily talking about it. And in particular, this one, because I think there's probably some conflictual reasons as why they don't. But these are some of the questions, like, I was just thinking, why is it that they're not? Is it because they're just biased? Is it because they just think that, you know, well, we don't want to support the behavior by addressing it, you know, by addressing behavior, we're going to support it. And it's because they said, well, they just see it as a sin versus just a sickness. Okay. Some research has been, I'm going to put these up, but I think you guys know. I mean, AIDS is just running out of the community. You know, it's declining among white populations and increasing among African Americans. While African Americans only make up 14% of the population, they account for over 60% of all the AIDS cases. And I think this is as of 2003 data, but I think it's even up now to 70%. 2002 is up to 72% of AIDS cases. And still remains to be the leading cause of death among African Americans between the age of 25 and 44.
If everything has gotten worse with the advent of all the drugs, and the young people think they're going to live forever, and now they think, well, if they get it, they can take a drug and they'll be okay.
Yeah, I heard that too.
Yeah, it's just unbelievable to me.
That is something that I've heard as well. It's like, well, you know, if I get it, they got drugs now. And it's sad because they're looking at Magic Johnson and thinking, well, now he has it, but it's undetectable in him. But the fact is, Magic had a lot of money. He had a lot of pharmaceutical companies sponsoring him. So he got the cream de la cream of services when it comes to HIV. But the strains are so varied, and it takes a while to find the medication that really helps you to fight it off, that, you know, people just don't have the kind of money to spend, and more than likely, they may or they may not spend that kind of time to help you find that medication that's going to work as perfectly. I know someone who he's full blown, and none of the medications helped, and so the doctors, or the side effects were worse than the actual helping of the disease, and the doctor just took him off meds. Said, well, you know, you're doing okay, your T cells are up, you know, your viral load's down. So, you know, if you get worse, you come back and we'll give you something. But they just took them off the meds because nothing was helping. Anyway, along the lines of where how it's affecting the community, it's definitely affecting the community among Black African Americans. I'm going to speed this up because I got a lot to share with you. I want to get to the good part. And of course, as you said before, heterosexual is the most predominant way of contracting it. And it's also spreading along, increasing among African American babies.
That's a horror. That's a horror.
Now, some research has been done. Back in 92, Crawford and his colleagues did some research similar to this. And I used some of his stuff in my research. And he found that clergy with professional degrees were less likely to believe that AIDS was a punishment by God than their less educated counterparts, and that older ministers were more judgmental towards the heterosexuals, HIV, and individuals with HIV than their younger counterparts. I found similar results, but not exact. So I felt that given that Crawford had found this, and I felt that it would be, the attribution theory would just be a very good theory to test to see why is it that ministers are not becoming more involved. So I put together this theory. Well, if you don't know what attribution theory is, based on the belief that perceptions of causality are central to affective reactions and eventually the behavior, subsequent behavior. So it's kind of like this, there's an event, you assign controllability, then you assign responsibility, then you react, then you have an emotional reaction, and then you react behaviorally.
Could you do that a little bit more?
Sure.
I'm not quite getting the whole thing.
Actually, okay, sure. Let's say that.
I just think of me as a chemist, a scientist.
<That's>
okay,
<fine.
laughs> not of this kind.
Let's say that you had a friend that was supposed to meet you at the movie theater.
Okay. I like examples.
Oh, maybe I can can even use the one. No, I'm not going
to use the one today.
Yeah, no, I see. I can't do that. No, I'm not going
to. I knew you were.
It's too sensitive. Let's say that you had a friend that's going to meet you at the movie theater, and he or she showed up 20 minutes late, and you're sitting there in the movie theater. The movie is well on its way, and whatever. And he comes up and he said, "Oh, you know, I had a beer and I kind of sit down and I forgot about time, and then I remembered, oh, I was supposed to meet you." Well, how would you feel? You would say that he could have controlled that situation. He knew he was going to meet you. You would say, he's responsible for it. Uh-huh. Okay? And therefore, you would get angry and you say, you know what? Later. Okay? So you would leave him. You would not want to interact with him. Versus if he would come to you and say, "I just got a phone call. I just heard that my mother died, or my uncle died, and I just totally forgot, and so I finally I remember that I was supposed to meet you."
That would be understandable.
Okay. So you would say, "Well, he wasn't necessarily in control of that. You know, you wouldn't assign responsibility." You would say, "Well, okay, so you're not
responsible.
Stuff happens." You'd probably feel sorry for him. And you'd probably say, "Okay, well, you know what, let's recover the evening. Hey, let's go on to the movie." So that's basically how the attribution theory works.
Okay.
Okay?
I get it.
Is that clear for everyone? All right. here's some of the models that have been used. And again, going through in regards to HIV. So this is the typical model that's been used. Someone contracts AIDS, if they assign controllable causality, they assign responsibility, and they become angry, and they don't help. Okay, so someone comes to them and says, "Well, I got AIDS because I was having sex I knowingly had AIDS with someone who, I knowingly had sex with someone who was HIV positive." Of course, then you're like, "Well, you know what, that was your fault." Versus someone who contracted AIDS unknowingly, or you probably do not assign controllable causality, and you would assign less responsibility. You're probably more sympathetic to them, and you'd probably be more willing to help them out. So that's the typical model. This is the one that Weiner, who I kind of model my research after, he had implied the whole notion of conservative theology in his work. So I decided I was going to test it. So he said, "Well, probably someone who's more conservative would be less helping. Someone who's more liberal would be more helping and understanding." So I decided to put this in force. And then I decided also, I wanted to just see, because the implication of whether someone is conservative or liberal does not necessarily mean that someone is sees it as a sin or a sickness. So the more liberal person may or may not see it as a sin, the more conservative person may or may not see it as a sickness. So I wanted to test to see if these things were indeed true. So I felt that the conservative, someone who had a conservative ideology would definitely see it as a sin. This is what I hypothesized. And therefore, will probably be less helping versus someone who's liberal ideology would probably see it more as a sickness rather than a sin, and would be more helpful. Okay. So I have three hypotheses, and I'm going to go through this kind of quickly. I said the liberal minister would be more educated, probably younger, less judgmental, The liberal, more educated, and younger ministers would be less judgmental and more likely to implement the AIDS program versus the conservative minister, which would be less educated, older, and more judgmental and less likely. And that's kind of based on the research by Crawford and some of the other research and attribution that's been done. And the second hypothesis is that I'm going to present these vignettes, and I felt that they would probably be more harsh, the homosexual vignette character, than the heterosexual character, that they were less harsh to the HIV, the IV drug user character, and the blood transfusion character. one is, I also felt that that same motion sickness thing, I felt that that was a true mediator, that that would determine exactly how they would end up helping people. Please feel free to ask me any questions you'd like. So if you're not, if it don't make sense, please, 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 raise your hand and ask. So I'm going through these kind of quick. I realize I got a time factor, and since Alice will not let me forget that I was late, I don't want to go over the time. But please feel free to ask questions. So this was the model I put together. I said that whether they're conservative, maybe their denomination and their political moral ideology would be a factor. And then I thought, also maybe these background variables may be a factor as well, like how many years they've been ministering. I did not assess if they knew someone with HIV/AIDS, but I did want to assess if they knew a lot. So the more you know about AIDS, of course, you know, probably less likely to be stereotypical of it. And then age and education, and that's kind of based on other research that's been done. And I felt that this right here would be a causal perception, whether they saw it as a sin or sickness, and that would be one of the determining factors. And I also wanted to assess their moral attributions, so how much they are moralistic towards someone in the way in which they contracted AIDS. And if that, okay, the outcome would be how much they endorse having an HIV/AIDS program in their church. So here's a little bit about who was in the study. As you can see, most of them were men, which I predicted. Most were married, which, you know, we knew. I was very surprised to find that there was, not surprised, but very highly educated. And there was a little difference between the conservative versus liberal ministers. So the conservative, the liberal ministers were a little more educated than conservative ministers, although it's not up there. And most of them were, as you can see, there's eight denominations represented in the study, and most of them were the typical, like Baptist, AME, CME, Pentecostal. And then we have the newer denominations, like New Thought and
Church of Religious Science.
Yeah, Church of Religious Science, exactly. And in regards to years of service, about 60% of them had less than 20 years, and 40% had over 20 years of experience. I'm just kind of dividing them up in categories. And most indicated that they had some additional training specific to being a minister. And then, as you can see, in regards to the employment, most of them were just ministers. So almost 60% of them had no other type of employment. No questions so far?
Okay.
Briefly, I used a lot of instruments to assess where these ministers were. In regards to the independent variables, I created a demographic and background questionnaire. I used the adapted questionnaire from McCrae, Hardy, and Lynn for the AIDS, knowledge, and attitudes. And I kind of put a lot of information, I put a lot of questions in there of just statistics that are being reported in the news and in the newspapers. So, and of course, they didn't do too well on that. I also looked at the level of conservatism, and then I created these attribution vignettes that I'll talk about in a minute that adapted from Walt Weiner, and this sin versus sickness, I took it from Crawford's work, and the attitudinal thing I also took from Crawford's work. All right, here's some of the things I asked. Take education, denomination, the size of congregation, youth, and the estimated number of active members, and as well as the estimated number of members with AIDS.
How would anybody know?
Yeah, that? And you
estimated.
Asked pardon me?
I asked for an estimated.
This is, you asked the minister?
Ministers to estimate, and it was categories, so. And I actually have that. It's not up here, but I do have it.
So they probably would base it on their interacting and counseling one-on-one with people. I mean, like they always say after the service, there are practitioners back there, and you're feeling, you know, you need to talk to somebody, go talk to them. That would be okay.
Which brings up a good question.
Sure.
When you say them, and you're talking about the clergy,
uh-huh.
Were you dealing mostly with the pastors?
Yep.
Or, okay, and not necessarily the youth minister or minister? Okay. Because they probably would have had more info, I would think,
yeah.
than the pastor.
So, well, what I was trying to assess, and I realize that this is, you know, lessons learned after now that I've done this, but because I did open it up to, if some ministers have other, like assistant ministers,
right.
I did open it up to them. So it had to be a minister who was in some type of decision-making position. And I was doing that because of the whole issue of implementing these programs.
Right.
So I may have gotten some ministers who were in the youth ministry, although they were not necessarily identified on this questionnaire. But I think if I were to do it again, I would probably open it up to, just, you know, instead of saying only to ministers who were decision-making, but open it up to all those who offer. Because, you know,
right.
some that type of, any type of service in your church, in the church.
Because they're in a position, they have recommendations for the minister
exactly.
to make a decision.
Exactly. And they probably would have, like Alex says, more knowledge of some of these things. So 58 or 75% of the members said that they had, there was less than 10%. Of the congregation that had, that they estimated had was impacted by HIV AIDS. So by calculation and by the representative percentage of today's population, do you think their estimation is correct?
No. Less than 10%?
Too low.
No.
Well, that's just like, this is one church, right?
Right.
Uh-huh. Yeah, so 10% in their church, right?
Yeah, in their church.
Right.
I think 10% would be too low, depending on how big the congregation is.
Yeah. And I do have that data, and I haven't done that analysis yet. I mean, to correlate the size of the congregation with their estimation. I was just wondering,
what's the national data on that? What percentage of the United States African American population?
I just did something on that, and it's not coming to. I don't have the national data. I did it for Los Angeles County. That's a good question.
Because I would think that, just like you were saying, you have those that know, mm-hmm. and then there might be a whole X number of percentage that don't even know mm-hmm. that they have, you know, the HIV.
Don't know yet. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Well, the question was the ministers, for their estimation. Like, you know.
Also, in many churches, many times, like anything else, those who are members of the church and go to church, maybe the population may not be affected as much as you ask the question, people in your family members, things like that, they probably know someone or know family members, and they know it probably shoots up much higher than the congregation that's there themselves.
Yeah.
Although I do think that even within the congregation, it's more than willing to come forward many times. It's a
right.
big issue. But still, a lot of times when it comes to a lot of vices and issues and social problems, mm-hmm. many people respond much quicker than in the family or in the community more than they do. Just themselves are speaking to a minister.
Right, because they don't want to be ostracized.
Right.
Yeah, ostracized, it's shame and things like that.
Yeah, and that's heathen. What I'm trying to get to, you know. I'm sorry, go ahead.
No, I said, you know, be called a heathen or,
yeah.
you know, any number of things. So, yeah, it's like you said, like even if you go back a few decades, and even now, you look at alcoholism, how many may actually let their, you know, clergy leader know, as opposed to maybe a social service individual who might be more unknown to them.
Yeah. And I actually do feel you, because one of the things I've been saying in the beginning was that, you know, in regards to HIV/AIDS, they've tried a number of avenues to get the message out, get the word out, but it just doesn't seem to be as effective. So where else or how else can they get the message out? You know, how else can they get this African American community to really take a look at what's going on? So a lot of organizations now are realizing that, okay, we do, for the black community, we do need to go to the churches. I mean, when I went to American Public Health Association conference back in December, this was a hot topic. I went to several talks on this. This is a hot topic across the nation about the ministers and the whole HIV/AIDS epidemic. So,
No, I was just going to say also that it may be, too, how the congregation perceives their pastor and minister. Because just as you were saying with your attribution model, if the pastor is perceived as being conservative, then people within their congregation may not feel mm-hmm. comfortable going in and talking to them. So their knowledge of how many people in their congregation are HIV positive may be affected by the persona that they put out to their congregation as well.
Well, I want to get to that.
Yeah, that's a great
discussion. That is so true.
Sexually transmitted diseases have been around forever. AIDS is just another thing down
right.
the line.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And certainly sexually transmitted diseases are prevalent in the population. We human beings love to be in denial. It won't happen to me. I won't get hit by the truck. I won't be in the accident because I'm speeding, ranting, red light, et cetera, et cetera.
Yeah. No, that is so true.
And Don was right. I mean, I go back to the model of alcohol. I mean, look at how many drunk drivers still you have out there. And ironically, it always seems to be the drunk driver that survives and not the people that they hit.
Right. That's
because
they're too drunk to feel anything. But yes, that is true. And in some respects, those things have gotten better. Now, I don't necessarily know if it's because of the churches that got involved, but this is just, to me, I just feel that this is, I targeted on HIV/AIDS because it was just an issue that came up for me at the time, but I think this can kind of go with a lot of, just health across the board. You know, we got diabetes that's running rampant, we have high blood pressure that's running rampant, so and I think we talked about this in one of the meetings where you have a lot of people in the churches that have high blood pressure, but yet when you go to these dinners, they serve fried chicken and greens with pork salt and all that stuff. So, you know.
Well, that was discussed as an African American church. What are you talking
about?
You want to change culture?
No.
No, you do. You. That correct answer is yes.
First of all, she wanted to change the proportions.
Yeah, right. No, but the correct answer would have been yes. Because if you got all the homecomings mm-hmm. and the ministers to say it's going to be a healthy homecoming or a healthy meal, then it may,
well,
do something.
But I feel that by saying that, you may scare some people off. All they have to do is change the way they're cooking things. They don't even have to say anything. Because,
Right.
And people will probably never know the difference.
Well, part of it is education.
Yeah.
Hey, that's what I'm getting to.
Well, so, I'll give you a high blood pressure statistic my doctor struck me with when she started me on medication 3 years ago. One third mm-hmm. of all women will develop high blood pressure just as a result of getting older. I had perfect blood pressure all my life, and then when I was about 60 or 61, about 3-4 years ago, it just started going up. But I listened. I went on the medication because I had a friend who wouldn't take his blood pressure medication years ago, had a stroke, was paralyzed, and then finally died. I mean, and the medications now they have many that are benign. They don't all have horrible side effects. I didn't have real high blood pressure. She didn't let it get that high before she said,
How high?
It was spiking in the 150s and the 80s, I would say. Mm-hmm. And I started on a diuretic that didn't quite do it. Then I went into an ACE inhibitor, mm-hmm. a little bit, and it did it, and a little bit, and it did it, and then again. So I'll probably have to have a little more or something. But you know, you can handle just every time you get near a restroom, you don't ask yourself if you need to use it, you just go use it. And the other thing, it gives you some mucus. I've got so many allergies, it's just more mucus. But compared to having a stroke,
right now.
She loves to say, just keeps pounding away in there, and then pounding away.
Retirement is the best one.
Alex.
That'll bring your blood pressure way down.
No, see, it has nothing to do with working. I've worked all my life, 45 years, and I didn't start. So I just want to share that with you women, okay? You should keep track of your blood pressure. You should know what it is, and it should be checked regularly because it's a silent killer. It has no symptoms. I'm feeling different now than I felt 10 years ago. But the little thing killed you. So I thought I'd share that with you because my doctor, Janet Fregler, she's a stickler for statistics. She's got them all nailed down.
Mm-hmm. You know, I talked about measuring the theological and the moral and the moral level of conservatism and AIDS knowledge. And these are some of the questions that came off the AIDS knowledge. You know, any person... Oh, that's not the right one, sorry. Actually, no, that's not the right one. I had edited those to ask more questions like the basic stuff. About what's going on in the community. And
did you come right out and ask these clergy if they thought it was a sin or it was a disease?
Well, here. This is what I asked them. There were three questions that I used to assess this. And I said, AIDS is God's way of punishing homosexuals, and they had a scale from 1 to 7. Higher ratings meant that they endorsed it, lower ratings that endorsed it less. And those are the three questions that I asked. And they were very significant. The difference between the two denominations. The two liberal and conservative. But I asked them about the AIDS knowledge, and I just wanted to point out here that the one question I asked them is, the AIDS virus was brought to the U.S. by conspiracy, and I think 75% of the ministers answered either probably true or definitely true to that. So that was, I was very surprised that they would even still believe that something, you know, that it brought to the U.S. as a conspiracy.
You talking about government conspiracy?
Yep. Okay.
They've all seemed pretty alarmed.
Yeah, I mean, you know, do you have evidence that it isn't?
Say it again?
Yeah.
No, it's all moving through the hard way, but based on conspiracy and trying to infect the African American community through the water.
She's too young for that.
Yeah, I guess so. But like he was just saying, I don't think beyond it, you can blame too many people for any type of belief of conspiracy theories considering what's been happening.
I know.
Yeah.
Yeah, but, you know, at some point, you got to. I mean,
you have to go beyond that and get and meet yourself and have a rational approach after that. I mean, you can have whatever behind your head you want, but when you want to make a change, make a difference, this is where we are. I mean, when I talk to young people, I tell them, I mean, you may think that there's, you know, black, you know, police are watching you and driving off back or whatever, but you don't have to keep stepping in the quicksand. You know where it is. So you still got to get beyond that. But, I mean, I don't blame them for having that thought.
Okay.
But you can't fall into.
Well, that's a good argument. I would have expected them to probably respond more like probably not true.
Especially the minister, I must agree with that type of population. But one thing I want to say real quick, I think I'm going to move on to ask questions about the sin versus sickness part, mm-hmm. and the whole reaching out to the black church and the association. Me myself, when I've read and seen a little bit, I think a little bit of it have put the churches on defense. And then defensive mode because of the way they were approached. And then by the time they were approached and the reaction by political leaders or whomever out there of saying that they're in denial, then you've already set up an antagonistic type of relationship. So now they're all like, you know, don't blame it all on us.
Yeah.
You know, get out of my face with it. It was, now you're going to blame me for it all. So I think the strategy to approach them and to get them involved, I think was flawed. Or if not flawed, but at least was not implemented in a good way, in a positive way that it should have been. And of course, I think politicians like to hit the headline, and as long as something's quiet, no money is attached to it, no appropriation bills, nothing else, you make some noise, on TV, get some headlines, LA Times, here comes some money, community matters, all right, we got the money, now let me go through my program. So, I think it's a kind of balance there with that.
Well, I want to hear more after this about your opinion, because what I'm going to propose at the end is along that line about what I feel needs to be done. But I want to just show you a little bit about, these are attribution questions that I ask, because the next set of data I'm going to show you will be the results of this. So I presented five scenarios. One was just says, so-and-so got AIDS, you know, and then I asked them seven attribution questions, and here are three of them. You know, how angry would you be at this person? How responsible do you feel this member is? And considering all the ways that this person, considering the way the person contracted AIDS, how much of it was due to forces within the member's control? Okay? So there were five. This one is, this scenario, oops, that's not scenario. This scenario is of the homosexual male. So he was somebody that's been in the community, and you know they've been losing weight, and you ask him what's wrong, and he says, well, you know, I have AIDS because I obviously had sex with someone, unprotected sex with a man in the bar. Okay? So the other one was a heterosexual male that also noticed he looked sick, and he admits that he had unprotected sex with an HIV positive woman. The third one was someone who was driving fast and had to get a transfusion and he got infected blood. And the fourth one was someone who had been in and out of the home, in and out of various shelters, and was using drugs. And used the needle that was infected on the male skin. Okay? So then we asked, after each of the scenarios, we asked those seven questions, the attribution questions. And just using a simple mean, looking at the means. So these are the five stories. So there's no cause, so I just said person got AIDS, you know. Then I have the homosexual, IV drug use, and heterosexual blood transfusion. And just taking an overall glance at this, okay, you can see that in the conditions, they were much more, overall, they were much more angry at the homosexual AIDS victim. But this one, much more angry. Although they all rated very low on a punitive scale, they were still much a little bit more angry at the homosexual victim, or punished them a little bit more, as regards to responsibility, same, they held them a little bit more responsible. They were, although this wasn't significantly different, they were less likely to extend services. They felt that it was much more the person when it came to the homosexual than the others. They felt that the homosexual AIDS victim was much more in control of what happened, and although they were high in sympathy, there was a homosexual victim that was got the least sympathy. But most of these went in the path that I thought they would go. So I thought that they would be much more angry at the homosexual victim, then the heterosexual victim, then the IV drug victim, then the blood transfusion victim. And I did the no cost, just to kind of give a baseline as just how they rate overall.
Question, why do you think it is that there seems to be less or more anger, it looks pretty much across every variable between IV drug users and heterosexuals?
Say it again?
It seems to be across every variable that there is less or either more anger, more punishment factors, or, you know, more responsibility on someone who's heterosexual versus an IV drug user. Why do you think that?
Because this is the difference in my research, and I hypothesized this as well, is that in other research they find that they are more angry at the IV drug user for really whatever reason than the heterosexual, right? But I hypothesize, because we're talking about the sexual issue, and I felt that they would probably respond more so that it was sex outside of marriage or sex, you know, that they would be responding to the homosexual aspect of someone having sex outside of marriage and contracting the disease. That's a good question. And I realized that you guys have all this stuff in your little pocket there. So I'm not going to go through all of it in detail. I'm actually going to fast forward to, remember that model that I showed you that I wanted to test me? This one? So, I did. I ran a structure equation model to test, to see if the data fit the model. And this is what I got. I know this is too far. I know, Alex, you told me to keep it casual, but
You got to show models. You got to show models.
Anyway, just in if you look at this, everything went into the direction I thought. So I definitely thought the more conservative you would be, the more likely you would see it as a sin, the least likely you would endorse the programs. I also felt that, although I felt that AIDS, the more conservative you would be, the less knowledge you would have about AIDS, but there is no correlation there. However, AIDS knowledge did stand alone as a predictor. So the more AIDS knowledge you knew, the less likely you would see it as a sin, the more likely, the more AIDS knowledge you had, the less likely you would see it as a sin, and the more likely you would endorse having these programs in your church. And the more attribution was stood on its own as well. So, the only thing that didn't turn out was this. According to this data, the more attribution you have, the more likely you would endorse the HIV/AIDS programs. And I think that, you know, I think maybe I need to go back and look at my data, but I don't know if an explanation could be that, well, of course, the more moral you are about these things happening, then they will say, well, yes, we need them in here. We need these services.
So not moral attribution about having contracted AIDS, but moral attribution towards sympathy towards a human being who needs help.
Huh. No, that wasn't how I was looking at it.
No, that wasn't how you were looking at it, but that's what occurred to you.
Yes. I wasn't looking in terms of sympathy, but more in terms of being judgmental. Say, well, yes, you know, these people did something wrong, so therefore they really do need to have
I would definitely add judgmental/judgmental there to be clear.
Moral/judgmental?
Yeah.
Yeah,
you're
there's a lot of stuff I need to cover.
Are you saying morals just in terms of what society feels is, you know, a standard of morals? Is that what you mean?
No, this measure of moral was based on those vignettes.
The vignettes that you had.
So I collapsed the anger, punishment, and two others, I think, which are the kind of the central to attribution. Okay. And so I was looking at the moral attribution of it. We title it moral because it's an implication. When someone makes a judgment on you, it's an implication that it's a moralistic kind of thing. And that's why I said I may have to go back to my data because maybe there's something in there, but that's what this little figure tells you right here. So everything went in the as far as my hypothesis went, everything was supported. Only this thing right here was kind of odd.
You know, Tina, what might have been good too mm-hmm. is if you had a question in there where they could compare maybe something like apples almost with apples, like if there were another kind of disease that you might have got. Let go back to alcoholism mm-hmm. and see what their thoughts would have been on that versus mm-hmm. having HIV and how much of the moral issue would have come out. Because generally, these days, you know, having alcohol is more accepted than it was maybe 50, 60 yeah. years ago.
And probably, you know, AIDS is a little more accepted than it was back in the
80s,
when it first came out, but you've seen as enough, but still, yeah. That's a good, so I'll come to you when I get ready to do my future study.
But my consulting fee will have gone up now.
I don't know, Alex, you keep bringing up this alcoholism, you're trying to tell something.
It's Thursday, I need a drink.
So did you ever ask one of the pastors maybe, like, did anybody, did you ask them if they thought that was a sin? And they actually said, oh yeah, I think it's a sin.
In the questionnaire, there were those three questions.
Mm-hmm.
And I'll go back to them. That I used to measure.
Oh, so it's sort of like you predicted it. Because I was thinking, you know, like if they thought it was a sin, then you would think they would address it just so that that would be avoided, you know. So, you know, usually when like they say it's a sin, then they try to see ways you could avoid committing the sin.
Uh-huh.
So it's sort of like if they think it's a sin, then they should target it more strongly so that people don't do it. And they're like more aware of these
things. Yeah, that's what I was kind of implying with the model as to why, well... Right, you were saying if they saw it as a sin,
that they would endorse it more, like more programs to avoid it, you know, without having to say necessarily AIDS, but more like what leads to AIDS,
mm-hmm.
so that people avoid those things.
Well, one of the things in the clergy, on their, well, they teach, they preach, and I do mean preach, abstinence.
Right.
If a lot in the targeted groups that has the highest numbers, so. If they figure if you don't listen to that, then you're getting what you deserve.
Yeah, but I think like that's really wrong. I think like I mean, it makes like probably like ideally, you know, maybe that would be the best thing, you know. But in the way things are right now, that
right.
it's very realistic because people are not gonna follow that, you know. So they
yeah.
should, yeah, they should.
But that's what she's saying, that they think they deserve to be punished. And
yeah,
that's what
they say, well, you don't do this, then this
right.
is what you get.
But at the same time, I mean, ministers argue, preacher give a message, and I think, again, about the setup. Myself, I think that if you approach, if you go to a minister, at least from my experience,
wait,
to a church and say,
let me,
talking about what is sin, what's not sin, and to me, the conversation is dead right then.
But this is what I'm getting to. This has implications for, to create a very comprehensive training for ministers. I think there are a few out today, but I don't know exactly how they are structured, but... first of all, I believe that these biases do exist, and some people may not say them, but I think that there's the conversation needs to occur about this whole issue with homosexuality among Americans. And definitely, if we do not really get a handle on this, I just see it being far-reaching in the future. You know, where we have babies that are coming up with HIV, women that are childbearing age with HIV, so therefore. Less likely to have children, you know, so you see it as a culture. It's definitely something that needs to be done right now. I'd see a potential for an HIV AIDS prevention training for ministers. And in looking at my data, that some of the differences that I found, it could be in personal susceptibility. So, you know, when it came to them responding to something that could apply to them, they were much more judgmental and less likely to support it. And feel that, oh, it couldn't happen to me, kind of thing, and just give an overall response to how I look at them individually. And that we perhaps need to develop a program of ministers that need to be exposed to more people with HIV. Where they got people that come in and talk about their experiences. I think in this training, all ministers just need to kind of assess exactly how much they know about HIV. Because that doesn't hurt anyone. And for them to know how much they know about it, I think when they get an idea, understand it, how much they don't know about it, perhaps that will encourage them to know more about it. And these trainings need to target ministers by providing factual information through seminars. Okay. I think also ministers need to be reminded that God's way is to show you the way. So they're taking on this preaching to the people. It's their, I guess, responsibility to give them the information. They don't have to support or condone any of the behaviors out there that they may think are sinful. But to get them the information, that should be how they should think about their part in this. So it's not that we're holding the ministers responsible, but don't blame us for that information, but to kind of enlighten them, well, you know, there's something that you can do. You know, you can't, okay, you can't preach to the people to change their behavior, but there's information that you can give to them that could possibly ultimately result in a change of behavior.
But I think, okay, that's rational thought.
Mm-hmm.
We're talking about because the majority of the African American ministers are older, and they're old school. As a matter of fact, it was, I think it was only like a month ago, Derek, you might remember this, where this minister got replaced at his church because he said he was doing the very same thing that you're talking about, advocating for more women's rights, advocating for gay, you know, programs and you know, information about HIV. And you've had your hand up for a while.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I just want to make a comment. I think I agree totally with what you're saying. I think it's absolutely valid. And I think if you look at any religion across the board, the people who are the ministers and whatever you want to call them, the maulana, the priest, whatever, I think those are the people who will not support this, because anything you are doing is you're wrong. You're not supposed to be having sex in the first place. You know, you're not supposed to be having sex out of marriage, you know, those kinds of things. But isn't the focus not just to, I mean, the focus should be educate these people and tell them about HIV and let's educate them. But also, isn't there a dissonance between the community and the ministers? Because these are the people who are putting the ministers in the powerful positions where they can dictate to them what it is they need to know and should know. So shouldn't we be looking at the people who put these ministers in the first place? I mean, I don't know how they get validated.
Well, that's her next slide, because most of that, you're going to say they're self-selected.
Yeah,
that's what it is.
The ministers are self-selected, but also I wanted to add on here is that one of the things that came up is the congregation. And I think someone was implying that they brought it up, but it really contradicted my focus, because I was going after ministers who were in leadership positions, right, to make decisions. But someone said, you know what, the congregation also has influence on what's talked about in the church. I actually met the minister at Holman, and he said to me, back in 1987, he wanted to talk about it, because I guess he had a few people that, but he had, this female who was high ranking in the church came to him and said, please don't talk about that. Please, I don't want to hear about it. And I guess she had lost her son to it. Mm-hmm. And he had a homosexual lifestyle. But it was more so shameful for her about the homosexuality. But she still didn't want him to talk about it, so therefore, he never brought it up. And he said to this day he wished that he would have spoken up and said more at that point. But I think looking at the influence of the congregation is definitely something that's worthy of my future research. Let me ask.
No, I was going to say it's interesting that you say that, because I was sitting here thinking that if maybe ministers did not detach themselves so much from what was going on within their congregation, that maybe they would have a more sympathetic point of view. But you just in what you just said, that just contradicted it, because here you have someone who saw, you know, what happened firsthand, and maybe it wasn't a, you know, a situation of this person doing something wrong, but just something happening to them as a result of something, but then her not even wanting to take that information that she knew firsthand and pass it along.
So and that was in 92. Maybe she would be different today, but that was when it was.
But you know, there is a gray area here, because I don't want it to seem like it's black and white. I know a pastor of a very prominent church who, like you were saying, with Holman, that the public persona is they stay away from it. There might be an education group, and they lump everything under health, you know, diabetes, hypertension, HIV. But a number of them do counsel privately and offer information that way. And then you look at, okay, whether or not what's best, you know, the person that really has it and needs it, that private counseling, or the ones that are you don't know about in the church. We were talking about the 10%, and who are waiting to find out what the stance is going to be of the pastor, whether they're going to be very conservative or not. So I mean, oftentimes you really don't know, because there's a private, you know, and then there's the public side, and you know, your survey probably gave you a better feel, because they know none of their congregation was really looking at it. It's in, you know, a secret, etc.
I don't know who that is.
Ladies
first.
Oh. No, I was just going to say, but then how do you... that type of information, I mean, it's affected such a large percentage of African Americans that at this point, it's not something that should be just done in a one-on-one mm-hmm. session. Because the majority of people who need to know this information aren't coming to people on a one-on-one. So how then do you, I mean, where then is the responsibility to take it out of that, you know, that little small group and disseminate that information to everyone, whether they know whether they feel like they want to hear it or not, because the reality is they do.
Well, what they do is they justify it by putting in that health group. You know, when you go to church and you look at the program, there's like, most churches now, they have like 15 to 20 different committees and groups. They put in the health education, and then justify, that's how they justify it.
Right, but I'm saying, then do we get them to take it out of that group, that small group,
well, you can't,
and discuss it where
because
it needs to be discussed?
They're like elected officials.
Yeah.
And I say this because it's just like what she was saying about the pastor with Holman. Mm-hmm. You have very powerful constituents who don't want to hear that, don't want the pastor to talk about it, and they have to maintain their persona with the church. Because essentially, they work for the congregation. Mm-hmm. You know, they might get their orders from the man upstairs, but they work for the congregation.
Right.
And they don't want to be ostracized, and they don't want to do anything that's going to divide the church.
Right.
So,
no, I agree.
You know,
I'm saying the problem is
of course, the problem is so big now that you have to do it.
Right, are looking to the church to be that center of our community, but the center of our community
and that
doesn't want to.
Oh, I'm sorry. Can I address her?
No.
That is what I heard when I went to this meeting, is that the people were saying, look, you need to come to me. I'm out here, I need you, but I can't come to the church because y'all are going to ostracize me if I'm HIV positive. And I can't take that risk of being ostracized. So if you want to help me, you need to come to me. And ministers up on the panel, they still didn't quite get it. But I understood what they were saying is, you know what, make an effort to come out from behind the pulpit and meet people. Go to the AIDS agencies and shake hands with folks and say, won't you come to my congregation? That's basically what they were saying. So, but I do feel that it's, you're right, there's a lot of gray areas here where you have some churches that are much more focused and have a much more interactive hand in getting the message out in addition to AIDS, above HIV and AIDS, with just health issues and stuff like that. So it's quite a quandary. He has had another to you.
This situation sounds a lot like South Africa one, our pandemic started.
Yeah.
You had the church, and the setup is the same as over here. But as more people were starting to die, and more people were starting to get infected, because no one was talking about it,
right.
The ministers got together and said, look here, I mean, we can't afford not to talk about it, because we're playing Russian roulette here. Are we going to continue to sit on our hands and say, well, and accuse the people who have it of being sinners, and this is God's way of punishing them? While we watch people die, or we're gonna open our mouths and start talking about it, and then get it out there. So, because if the community sees that the churches are talking about it, guess what? Then they're gonna feel free enough to start talking about it among themselves, and that's what we had to do. In the United States, as you were saying, the statistic you put out there, that 60% of all new AIDS infections are sisters. That's ridiculous. If the churches are talking about it, then of course everybody out in society is not gonna talk about it. Well, it's a church, and they're supposed to be following the word of God, and then and all these people are dying, and no one's talking about it. You let AIDS win when you don't talk about it. And in South Africa, we had to come to a conclusion, because even when people started talking about it, it still wasn't that big of an impact until Nelson Mandela's oldest surviving son died. Then all of a sudden, he came out one day wearing I'm an HIV/AIDS positive t-shirt, because prior to that, what they were doing with people in my country that was AIDS infected, they would either stone them to death, or their family members, the ones who were full-blown AIDS, they would put them on a blanket, take them out in the bush, and okay, lions and cheetahs and leopards, dinner time, and leave them. Because I had an uncle that was dead like that. One of my dad's brothers. He was full-blown AIDS, and his family put him on a blanket, put him in the back of a truck, took him to Kruger National Park, laid him out there. He was alive. And said, okay, lions.
Well, you know, Robert's right about one point, and I just want to say this real quick. The church needs to start talking about it more. Because if you look at recent examples, the bird flu, which has got like a slim chance and I don't know what, of affecting most of us, but more people are panicking over that and getting shots and everything else. Whereas you see this, and I think part of it is the clergy is not around victims enough to see that it is an epidemic and it's really affecting our community.
There's theory about responsibility and lack of responsibility. So they figure with AIDS, you're responsible. With the bird, even that flu, it's not.
Very good. Yeah.
I mean, it's almost back to that point.
Is that back to attribution, you know?
Shouldn't grow your own chickens? Is that
no. No. If you get the bird flu, it's not your fault. Right. You know, it's just, you know, somebody else
it just happens to
get AIDS, right. You know, it's because you done did something wrong.
Well,
but the issue is that
still seen as a homosexual disease.
Right.
But you know what? So what I'm trying to propose here is by exposing them and getting them just information that you know, because they need to understand. Well, what happens? How do you feel about the person who got it in a committed relationship? You know, how do you feel about the woman who mistakenly breastfed her baby, not knowing that she was HIV positive, or the person who's working in the hospital and got pricked with someone, you know?
Mm-hmm.
There's all these circumstances that go beyond just the sexual aspect of it. Yeah, I want to get Autumn, and then I'll get her, and then I'll come back to you.
Okay, well, I was wondering about how effective would you think if the ministers were on board with, okay, I do want to say something to my congregation, and I do want to start these programs, how effective overall you think that it could be? Because I think that with HIV, like we're saying, there's lots of, it's a big taboo, where it's like really hush-hush, but there's lots of issues in the African-American community that are not talked about, like sexual abuse, rape, molestation, and it just seems like it's all under this umbrella of the secret things that occur in the community that is not allowed to be discussed. And so I feel like if possibly a veil was lifted on lots of subjects,
and that's what I'm saying. We need to, in addition to HIV/AIDS, we need to. It's like to be this umbrella of health and other topics that need to be discussed. Because you get to health to talk about child sexual abuse.
Because what she said, although I know we all brag about our church where we go, but one thing about my church, as an example, when our minister spoke about AIDS and had all the experts that they're talking about in our congregation, and I think it's an example of most churches. The congregation really do kind of respond to the leadership. It was a great spot. I mean, Shane was thrown out the way. I mean, these people really just walked up there, got in line, and wanted to be a part of the program. I mean, they were eating it up. I mean, these people, our congregation was really into it. And the way it's presented, that's why I say presentation is so important. That's why I get more anger at those who are presenting and putting churches on defense. But I think you got to approach this right, because if a minister stands up there and do it the right way, that whole congregation would turn out and respond in a positive way. Our example, I think, is an excellent example. The way our minister did it and the way the experts were there, the way they broke down some stats, those people responded greatly. And they were all, no shame, nowhere. Everybody just was one family. They sat up there, and no one said, I'm not going up there. Only two people went up there. No, I mean, almost half the church went up there and responded to the information.
So I'm going to have to get your number to talk to you.
So there were no Karl Malones there.
Yeah. And it's a female pastor, though, so that's probably
See, well, there you go. That makes all the difference. Sorry.
I just wanted to intrigued by what you said, because I was in Zimbabwe last summer, and it was a church organized trip, and I'm not a member of the church that organized the trip, and we're going there to work with AIDS orphans. But in Zimbabwe alone, it's something like 60% of the population is HIV positive. Mm-hmm. Botswana is even higher. And I think that's actually gone down in Zimbabwe. I think it's gone down. But it's something like 59-60%. Mm-hmm. And the irony is that everywhere the church is putting out the message about AIDS education and addressing AIDS issues and HIV. The other ironic thing is in the United Methodist Church, there's a brouhaha now over, well, it's not just the Methodist Church, but over gay marriage. And I think on a national level, it's the United States organized Methodist group believes that it's the African ministers that are going to have some impact on how
the U.S. ministers will deal with the whole issue of gay marriage, which is, the Bible is clear on being, that this is an abomination, blah, 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 blah. But, so the irony, but the irony is that this is the stance that the church is taking on this particular lifestyle, but nobody's asking that question.
Right.
Zimbabwe is an issue, and the church is dealing with the issue.
That's what I'm saying. You don't have to, I would like for them to move away from acknowledging or, you know, endorsing some type of behavior, but to focus
just
on
deal with
the issue. You know, there's these health issues, one being HIV/AIDS, that, you know, that's some information to pass on.
What did you factor in? Did you factor in the American Puritan historical experience to this lack of communication by ministers to the issue of HIV/AIDS? And it's very important because this country was founded by the Pilgrims and Puritans that came here.
No, what I factored in was the fact that historically the black churches have been the leaders of African Americans. I mean, if you were to look at when it comes to something that needs to get done, who's out there in front? The Reverend so-and-so, the Reverend Dr. so-and-so, it's the minister.
Right.
So in regards to leadership in this country, those are our leaders. And historically, the churches have been the place where we came when we were running away from the slaves, when we, you know, when we were passing messages from one congregation to another through song. It's the black church that's been the
civil rights.
You know, civil rights, exactly. Who was up there? Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King. So that's where I came from. But that may have factored in. I don't know. I can't go that. I need a historian for that. Did someone have another question? Okay. Alex, you want to say? You know, I do want to address something, though. This was a population of 77 ministers. I went to Minister Alliance meetings several times. I begged. That's how I got them. If I got the number, I was on the phone calling all the time. I don't know the refusal rate, but I had a really pretty good response. So once they got the survey, they actually sent it back. So I think it was like 73%. So that was really, really good, because usually return rate is about 30%. But that was because I called and I bugged them a lot. But I do realize that it's a very self-selected group of ministers, and I didn't even touch, you know, the 50 or 60,000 that are here. I just went to these minister alliances that I knew of and recruited. So probably your minister wasn't part of that alliance, or she or just didn't respond. And the one thing I realized after chasing them, because they were so busy, I mean, really busy, that they have a lot of responsibilities. And I think someone brought up something about some of the other stuff that they're responsible for. Yes, I do realize that they are very busy. They got a lot of stuff. And maybe this just wasn't something that they put at the top, because they were dealing with so many other things. For example, I was sitting in an office with the minister. Because he said, the only way I'm going to do this survey is you sit and you do it, you give it to me. So I was there, and he phone call. It took me twice as long to get that survey done. It had he done it on his own. But, and just the various problems that he was addressing, and one of the things that just really kind of put us at a stop still for a minute was he got a call from somebody whose mother had died, and she wanted the minister to take a minute and say a prayer. And I guess he knew this woman, and it just took him by surprise that she had passed away. So, you know, I guess there's so many other things that they're probably dealing with that maybe, and for this group of ministers, that they, you know, had other stuff that was on their mind. But that doesn't, to me, that does not negate the study. I think it has some relevance out there.
No, I think the study had a lot of relevance, and I think you can build on it.
Mm-hmm.
And some of the comments that you put on what you would do differently, I guess that's the next slide. you know.
Well, I think these are some of the things that I already put out there that I would do. I'm not going to go through them, but strategically, I would probably do some of the other things differently. Like, I would talk to the congregation. I'd probably ask the ministers if he knows of, he or she knows of the congregation's attitude towards talking about this. Someone brought up something. One of the things I would do differently. But I'm in the midst of trying to create a curriculum based on those things that I talked about, how to ask the minister just to assess what you know, so that it's not threatening. It's not about, well, you're dumb, you're stupid, but just, you know what, let's just see how much you know about it, and we'll take it from there. And
move forward. Well, I mean, I think you're on the step in the right direction by serving on the Bunche Center's Black LA research project, and that could be something, there could be a chapter that's being researched on now. And because you have to ask yourself, with all of the issues that are out there, why don't you have someone who steps forward and makes that their issue, like Robert was saying that Mandela did.
Mm-hmm.
Because the numbers are really bad. And it's not, and I think one of the biggest things is it's still so much that people don't see it. If this were cholera, if this were like leprosy, where you could, and it's all around you, people would react differently. And some of the effects can be the same, but people don't see it that way. Or they don't see it at all.
Because unless somebody tells you, you would never know.
Right.
It's just changing the whole perception that it's just a disease based on homosexuality. That's the
right.
biggest thing. People are still stuck on how the disease was presented when it first, came about. Is that it was solely a disease, or from what people believed, only within the homosexual community. And people still hold on to it, even though the majority of people who have it are heterosexual.
Well, it's still very prevalent among MSM.
Right.
But the increase, the worry, is mm-hmm. that it's increasing mm-hmm. among heterosexual women.
And back to what you said, that unless somebody tells you, you wouldn't know. I think, like, everyone in this room is informed about HIV and AIDS, I understand ministers have, like, the responsibility of telling the congregation about it, but it's also everyone, like, here in this room, responsibility to tell as many people as possible about it, too. We had to start educating people close to us. So that was going to start expanding, more people are going to know about it.
Mm-hmm. Oh.
Not just keep it, sometimes, like, we know things, but we never tell anybody. So it's like, there's no point to knowing if you're not going to tell anybody, So you have to tell people around you.
Yeah, and one of the ways that you could do that is that there's always events that are going on, and December 1st, as you know, is World AIDS Day, and so you can always say, hey, why don't you come to this event that's going on? Make it your business to know where some of the things are, and you can invite people who may not go on their own. That's one thing. It's a very good point.
Yeah, and just really quickly, also, here in UCLA, we had the UCLA Dance Marathon. I don't know if you've heard about it. It's mm-hmm. going to be February 18th and 19th.
Mm-hmm.
And so any donations, they're doing for the Elizabeth Glaser Pediatrics Foundation.
Right.
And so it's a big movement. It's been there for, I think, 3 to 4 years now.
Right.
So,
Do you have any information on it, or flyers or anything?
Well, I can write down that it's UCLADanceMarathon.com.
Yeah, it's in the Daily Bruin.
Yeah, it's on the Daily Bruin.
That's a mistake.
Thank you guys so much.
Thank you, Tina. Nadia. Entrance.
Have you already met with him?